Welcome to the Hinckley Institute of Politics. My name is Kendall, and I will be the host for today's Hinckley Forum. The Hinckley Institute was established in 1965 through the generous bequest of the Noble Foundation and Robert H. Hinckley. The Institute is dedicated to teaching students respect for practical politics and the principle of citizen involvement in government. The Hinckley Institute offers paid internships to students of all majors here locally in Washington, D.C., and in 35 countries around the globe. The Hinckley Institute also offers classes, the nation's only campaign management minor, week-long experiences to Washington, D.C., and over $70,000 in academic scholarships. We invite students to go next door or to our website, www.hinckley.utah.edu, for more information. The title of today's forum is Women in Utah Politics, and I will introduce Ms. Anne Burkholder, who will be introducing our guests. Anne is the Chief Executive Officer of the YWCA. Please join me in welcoming her.
It's great to see all of you here today. I can't decide whether you're tormenting those of us up here by eating delicious pizza, but I'm glad that you're able to do that and glad that you're here today. The YWCA is interested in women's empowerment and women's leadership, and that's why we have been involved, along with the Hinckley Institute, with a collaborative nonpartisan effort called Real Women Run, to encourage and train Utah women to run for public office, to serve on boards and commissions, to participate in political campaigns, and generally to become actively involved in political life. The YWCA convened the first meeting of what became Real Women Run in just 2 years ago, in September 2011. Before we turn to some questions for the panelists, I would like to begin with some selected statistics about women in public office. We are half the population, but we are not proportionally represented. And in Utah, in 2013, just 17 women served in our 104-member state legislature. That's 16.3%. You are seeing almost 25% of the women in the Utah state legislature here in this room today. Utah ranks 46th among the states for legislatures with percentages of women. Our historic high was in 2002 when 24 women were in the legislature, about 23%. No Utah women are currently elected to Congress, and no Utah women are currently elected to state office. In the United States, after the 2012 election, 78 women serve in the House of Representatives, 20 in the Senate. 98 is a record number for Congress, but that's only 18.3% of a 535-member body. Five governors are women. Statistics show that women running for office win elections at the same rate as men, but nationwide, fewer women choose to take the initial step to run for public office. And women vote in higher numbers than men and have done so in every presidential election since 1964. These statistics underscore the importance of our conversation today. I'm honored to introduce four panel members who are a perfect mix for a stimulating conversation about women in Utah politics. Each is an active and current member of the Utah State Legislature, and I'm confident that you will benefit from the insights of these outstanding leaders. I'm just going to go one after the other, starting with Senator Deidre Henderson, who was elected to the Utah State Senate in 2012. Before jumping into politics, she spent 13 years as a stay-at-home mom. She and her husband, Gabe, have been married for 20 years. They've built a successful business and are raising their five children, ages 18 to 10, in Spanish Fork. Her foray into politics began in January 2008 with an unpaid position on the insurgent congressional campaign of Jason Chaffetz. She organized volunteers in Utah County and eventually became political director, where she provided strategic and logistical leadership to the 1,000-person volunteer force. After Congressman Chaffetz was elected to the U.S. House of Representatives, Deidre served as his campaign manager until March 2012. She currently serves on the following legislative committees, boards, and commissions: She's chair of the Senate Revenue and Taxation Committee. She serves on the Senate Business and Labor Committee, the Social Services Appropriations Committee. She's chair of the Federal Funds Commission. She serves on the Utah Lake Commission, is chair of the Transparency Advisory Board, and serves on the Open High School of Utah Board. To her left, Rebecca Chavez Hauk, a Utah native. She has represented constituents in Utah House District 24 since January 2008. She serves as co-chair of the House Ethics Standing Committee. Other committee assignments include the House Government Operations and Health and Human Services Standing Committees, Health Reform Systems Task Force, Economic Development Task Force, Health and Human Services and Revenue and Taxation Interim Committees, and the Social Services Appropriations Subcommittee. She has successfully sponsored 11 bills that have been signed into law and championed a number of other bills and resolutions. Rebecca has been appointed to serve as a House Democratic Caucus representative on the Governor's Multicultural Commission and the Governor's Working Group on Medicaid Expansion. Her professional experience has focused on nonprofit administration and public affairs over the past 28 years, and she has cultivated another career as an activist and volunteer in myriad nonprofit organizations locally. She's also an adjunct faculty member in the U's MPA program. Representative Rhonda Brud Menlove has served for 9 years as a member of the Utah House of Representatives, representing Box Elder, Tooele, and Cache counties. She is the House Chair of the Social Services Appropriations Subcommittee and serves on the Health and Human Services, Economic Development and Workforce Services, and Ethics Standing Committees. Representative Menlove is a Senior Vice Provost and Associate Professor in Special Education at Utah State University. She has also worked as a public school administrator and teacher. Luz Robles was elected in 2008 to the Utah State Senate, representing District 1, which includes the west side of Salt Lake City and parts of West Valley City, becoming the first Latina elected in the Utah State Senate and the first immigrant elected in the Utah State Legislature. In 2012, she was reelected to serve her second term in the Utah State Senate. She serves in the Senate leadership team as the Senate Minority Caucus Manager. She also serves in the Health and Human Services Appropriations and Standing Committees, as well as the Law Enforcement and Criminal Justice Committees. She has focused her legislative work on health-related, public safety, and veterans affairs issues. She has served in many capacities in different boards of nonprofits and other agencies, and she currently works as Vice President for Zions Bank in the newly formed Community Development Group. Please join me in welcoming these outstanding women today. I thought that I would pose a series of questions to the panel and then open up for questions. So I have some questions that I'd like to get the discussion started with. And let me start with you, Senator Henderson. What motivated you to run for political office, and what kinds of things did you think about before you declared your candidacy?
Well, before I declared my candidacy, I frankly, to be quite honest, was consumed with a lot of self-doubt. You know, was this the right thing for me to do? Should I let someone else do it? I had a, because of redistricting, we had an open Senate seat down in my neck of the woods. We got a new Senate seat. I live in Spanish Fork. And we got a new Senate seat down in South Utah County because of population growth down in that area. And so it was an open seat and a really good opportunity. And I had, for the last 5 years, been preparing myself, not consciously for this sort of opportunity, but because of the things that I had been involved with, I was prepared to jump into that race. But I think, like a lot of women I know, had some of those fears and doubts in my mind and had to really overcome that in order to step in and say, you know what, I'm going to do this. And there was another gentleman, a former member of the Utah legislature. He was in the House, and he was stepping out of his House seat down in my area and was going to run for the Senate seat. And I had so many people tell me, you run for his House seat and let him run for the Senate. And, you know, he wants to do that. He's going to run for the Senate. And it kind of had created the Senate district, I think, kind of for him. And I said that he's a great guy. I really like him. I have nothing against him, but I want to be in the Senate, and not and I love the House. The main reason is because of the 4-year term, if I'm being totally honest. I said, you know, I'm gonna. He's, you know, if he runs for the Senate, that's great. But I'm gonna run for the Senate because that's what I want to do. And he ended up not entering the race. He did end up supporting me, which was nice, but I just had to kind of overcome that initial reaction of mine to say, oh, he wants it? Okay, that's fine. I'll go do something else and let him do it. I had to kind of overcome that initial reaction in myself to say, you know, you're ready, you're prepared. Even if you're not, you'll figure things out and you're capable and go do it.
Great, thank you.
You know, I've been involved in nonprofit administration and public affairs for a long time, and at the same time I was cultivating this experience working for other candidates who were running on the Democratic ticket for various offices, and I would help them get elected, and I would go to door to door on their behalf and have conversations with constituents, and got to get a feel for what people in the neighborhoods and in our community were thinking and how they wanted to participate in public policy discussions. And after doing this for other people for a number of years, I looked in the mirror one day and just said, you know what, I so could do this. and my experience in the nonprofit world was helping nonprofit organizations work with government institutions and with the public to develop an environment within which they could do their mission. So whether I was working at the Museum of Natural History or Centro de la Familia or the Utah Public Employees Association, I was working with constituents at those different organizations and helping them interface with government. So I knew the processes very well. I'd helped them organize advocacy efforts on the Hill, both federally and locally. And so I knew the processes. I knew what I believed in, and so for me, it was just waiting for the right time. Again, it's kind of, you have a tendency sometimes, and I think women do this more frequently than men do. They overthink when is the right time. You're evaluating all of these different variables, but the time was finally right. I wanted to wait till my children were a little bit older before I jumped into the fray, and when then Representative Ralph Becker was running for mayor, I thought, this is the opportunity, I'm going to go for it. So it took a while, but only because I wanted to kind of get a feel for when the time would be right.
Representative?
Thank you, Anne. So my experience is a bit different. I hadn't ever thought of running for office. And I participated on a campaign in college because I was dating someone who was running a campaign, and that was a great opportunity, great reason to campaign. But I was teaching special education and law and graduate class, and one of my students came to me who lived in my community, and he said, Rhonda, you're always bashing the legislature. You know, you should put your money where your mouth is and you should run. And I laughed and I said, I don't think so. I have no desire. I've never thought about running for office. I'm basically a pretty private person. And so I said, you can surely find someone else to run. And I said, go look. And he came back in a couple weeks and he said, there's no one who will run against a 12-year incumbent because they know they'll be beaten. So, how about being the sacrificial lamb? So I said, let me give this some thought. I went back to my undergraduate class, my students, and I said to them, how would you guys like to participate in a campaign? And they were absolutely excited about it. I went to my kids who were mostly in college and who were all in either college or high school, and said, would you like to run a political campaign? And they said yes, and so I decided to run. And I thought to myself, this will be a great story for me to tell in my special ed law classes about how I ran for office. So I ran this campaign, learned an incredible amount. the night of the election, I'm sitting at my house. My husband said, do you want to go to the county offices where you can watch the election results? I said, no, I'm ordering pizza for my family and whoever wants to come, and I'm going to stay home and lose in privacy. So we're sitting in our little office. My husband and I were watching on the computer, and the results start to come in. And about midnight, my husband turns to me and says, I think you've won this election. I have to tell you, I was stunned, and then I got really sick. Because I thought, what do I do? I've just been elected to the House of Representatives. I know nothing about this. But actually, I did know a fair amount about law and policy. So I'm one of those people who came to the legislature without thinking I was going to do that. And I think that's important, that you don't have to be a career politician. You don't have to have this extensive background to come to the Utah legislature, because we are a citizen legislature, which is very exciting to me.
Well, thank you. You know, I think the questioning, or just the right time, is everyone is going to have a different story, and I so much respect and admire my colleagues, because it takes a lot of sacrifice, and people sometimes forget losing your personal private life and your family. So I think all of that stuff has to be combined as well as you make a decision like this. We all have family, friends, partners, significant others, and they're part of that decision. I think in my case, I was 28. I have a three-year-old little girl, and I had a chance to work as an advocate slash lobbyist for a low-income organization. So I was very aware of the legislative process, how to take care of passing a bill, what it takes to get 5 minutes out of a legislator to listen to you. And it was getting a little bit more frustrating by the minute, not being able to have a bigger impact. And I wanted to do more. Had a chance to work for Governor Huntsman. So I then went to the executive branch experience, eye-opening to learn about the budget and what it means to be on the other side, as you are now literally begging legislature for money and funding and understanding the dynamics of executive branch. And it was during one of those meetings, and I'll be blunt, it was an education meeting interim in May of 2007. And it was an eye-opening experience where, you know, many of them are still colleagues of mine, and there were some comments made at the meeting that were very painful and hurtful personally, and I had to get out of the room and was angry and went and just venting to people that I know, and they said, well, instead of complaining, run for office. I was like, oh, maybe this is the time. And, you know, we went into doing some just work into that, and had a chance to, during that time, transition to the private sector, which was very helpful, because I couldn't do this being a state government employee. It would have been very difficult. So we started the campaign and had a long process to get where in 2008, where we, you know, took on that Senate seat. And now, as I enter into a congressional race, which I announced last week, it's a totally different process, because that's, A, now I'm a state senator. You have to now make a decision based on that as well. But in all this process has always been the need for a change. This inside of me wanting to make a difference and feeling that it's not happening and I can't wait anymore. So that's the push and the drive that's been personally in my case what has taken me to run for office.
Thank you so much. Utah doesn't have a very good current record for having women in elected political office. What do you think the barriers are that are preventing women for running for office, and what can we do to encourage them? Luz, I'm going to start with you.
Sure. I think, you know, there is gender tends to be a big factor. You know, you may have age, race, ethnicity, you know, even professional backgrounds. I've seen in terms of gender, you know, there is some cultural components and dynamics that may come into play. But I think most Utahns understand how critical women are in every decision process. And I think we totally underestimate the constituents. I believe if we put more women to run for office, we will have more women elected. I think we're just mathematically not putting enough women on the ballot. But I believe there are some cultural components. I think if we have more women, our decisions will be different at the legislature. I can tell you, because it happens on the conversations. If you have the four of us here serve on social services appropriations, which tends to be probably one of the toughest, you know, committees to serve, just because of the type of decisions we're making that impacts people, their daily life. And I love those conversations. I mean, they're deep, we're making tough decisions, but because we have many women in that committee, you see changes in the way decisions are made. So I'm hopeful, but yeah, I mean, there are some cultural pieces. Women most likely are not gonna get asked to run. You know, it's mm-hmm. gonna take, like everybody mm-hmm. said, this drive of saying, I'm gonna do it. Mm-hmm. And everybody may say, oh, do you wanna wait? Why don't you just wait for your kids to get older? Or, you know, and at the end of the day, most women in Utah are working, whether it's part-time. You know, we have a lot of women in the workforce, and this is another job. I mean, mm-hmm. it's like any other job. So I think just being scared of politics can sometimes be what is a, you know, bring some dissonance of making that decision. It is a tough place to be. I mean, you have to grow some thick skin, and you're, you know, some maybe more mean than others when it comes to talking, but I see the capacity and capability of fixing and finding solutions with women in the table better than without having them.
Great. One of the barriers that I believe we have in Utah is that we don't have enough women who are in those positions and roles as role models for young women and for other women. They don't look at the legislature and see a lot of women who figured out how to balance home, family, and career. And I think you have to have unique circumstances that allow you to serve in the legislature. And I'm a mom, I'm a grandmother, I've had grandchildren born during the legislative session. There are things that I've sacrificed that I'm not able to do and be at during the session. And you know, that's taken a strong commitment from my own family, from my husband, to support me, and then my employer. And I work for an employer who values service in the legislature. So we need employers who will value it, but we also need to look at the culture of our families. And we have young men and young women here today. And, you know, I think young young men need to be thinking not only of themselves, what if I want to run for office, but what if my partner or spouse wants to run for office? And I think that's an important barrier we need to start overcoming with our young people. I'm worried about my generation. I'm not a really young person. But as I've thought about who would replace me, who could I start to mentor to serve in my position, I've talked with other women in the community who are educated, who are dynamic, who are leaders, who are, you know, interested in what happens at the state level. But they all just shake their heads and say no. And I think we've got to start, my hope is that we'll start with a new generation of women who are willing to balance career, life, and legislative service, and also young men who are saying, I would be happy to support my wife doing that. I think that would be great. So for me, you're our hope. I think it will take us generations probably to change. And it's unfortunate because Utah has an amazing history of women in public service. Somewhere we lost that, and we could go on have a long cultural discussion about when we lost that and how we lost it. But I think the hope is in you, and I'm looking forward to, I love working with the interns. I think it's so important that we all work together to increase the number of women serving.
I think that one of the things I'm so excited about, the Real Women Run campaign, and the reason we chose the name was we were trying to focus on encouraging women to not think that there's a certain type of woman that runs for office, that real women run, women that are moms, women that are school teachers, women that are grandparents, women that are young women that are going to school. You know, we wanted a woman to be able to look at this possibility and not think that she had to have a certain portfolio or certain experiences, but just by the nature of her perspectives, the way she approaches problem solving, which is often more collaborative and team building, bringing the relationships that she has in her wider world to the discussion of public policy development. We wanted young women and women at any facet of life to be able to say, yeah, I can do this. Because I think sometimes we do have a tendency to overthink. Is everything in place? Do I have everything in the right place? Whereas, you know, there are studies that have proven this, that predominantly men don't look in the mirror and overthink it. They look in the mirror and say, I'm going to run for office. And women think about, oh, I got to do this, got to do that, got to do this. So So I think that that's the one thing that I think is often a barrier is sometimes we overthink things, and I know that I am probably the one of the most guilty people of doing that.
I think I agree with these ladies. I think also expanding on that, one of the biggest barriers that I have seen in women predominantly is fear. A number of years ago, a very wise man told my husband that he said, "Don't take counsel from your fears." And that saying that I heard over 20 years ago has stuck with me. And every time I get that feeling, and I get it a lot still, if I'm asked to do a TV interview or a radio interview or, you know, do anything, I get that that knee-jerk reaction of mine is to say, "That's all right. No, I'm not going to do that." And every time I feel that, I think that's my red flag to say, you know what, maybe I better do it. Maybe I better go ahead and do the things that scare me. Because when I do the things that scare me, I grow. It's inevitable. And pretty soon those things don't scare me anymore. And so, you know, we all have this comfort zone. It's like a circle around us. And every time you get to the edge of it, you start to get a little bit nervous. But when you take a step outside that comfort zone, what happens to your comfort zone? It grows. And so you become more capable and more able to do the things that you're called on to do. Sometimes I have gotten so scared that I feel like I'm going to throw up. I was asked to be the chairman of the Revenue and Taxation Committee as a freshman senator. Now, I am the only woman on that committee. Now in interim, I have Representative Chavez Hoke with me, because we have joint committees in the interim. But in this, during the legislative session, we have separate standing committees, and I have these big wig men who are tax attorneys and very intimidating, very very knowledgeable, been there forever, and I was asked to chair that committee, and because of this fear in me, I wanted to make sure that I knew exactly what I was supposed to be doing. So I went in and had the legislative staff do mock committee hearings with me, and I practiced. I did a couple of those, and I tried to learn everything I could learn before the start of the legislative session, because I did not want to make a fool out of myself. And that first day came, and I honestly thought I was going to throw up. And the first committee meeting came, and it's the end of the day, and so I had to wait all day long with this feeling. And I had just gotten punked on the floor of the Senate with my first bill, everybody voting no on it. And I bombed. It was terrible. I couldn't remember what to say. I had to ask my staff member, I don't even know what to say. Tell me what to say. And it was terrible. But the next day, I did fine, and it was much better. And so I think that if women can learn, and men too, but I think sometimes men think, you know what, I'll figure it out. I may not know how to do it, but I'll figure it out. And they do. Women, we think, I can't do that until I know exactly how to do it. And so if we can just get over that fear, overcome that fear, and think, you know, if I face it, if I find what scares me and just go and do it, then I'll be a better person for it. And I think that is a key for having more women run for office here in the state of Utah and everywhere, and stand up for leadership position, not have vice chair syndrome.
Thank you very much. This next question goes to differences between men and women in political life. So I'm going to start in the middle. Representative Menlove, perhaps you would be the first to try on this question. How, if at all, do female and male politicians differ in the style and substance of their work?
We love men. Let's just clarify.
Yes, we do.
What do women bring to the table?
You know, and I don't want to stereotype men or women. And, you know, I try to be, in my mind, gender neutral. I try to be that way. But there are some qualities and characteristics of women, of female legislators, that I've observed. But there are also men who do these same things. And there are women who also do some things I'm going to say that, you know, anyway. So it really isn't gender specific as much as it is personality specific. But there are some gender issues that do come up. And one of those, I believe, is a desire to please. And I don't know if this is culturally generated in women and, or if it's just we want to make people happy, okay? And so that's very hard in the legislature. That's why you have different parties. That's why you have opposing positions and you debate because, so that's a challenge. But I've noticed many female legislators they're trying very hard to build coalitions, and I watch them, and they try to build consensus and constituency support. So I see that quality a great deal. The other aspect of that women, I believe, bring to the legislature is that we are women. We are different in gender, and we do have different biological and emotional experiences in our lives. And I'm a mom, and I'm a grandmother. And I have to tell you, being a mother, a wife, a grandmother influences what I do in the legislature. I think my experiences with toddlers and teenagers prepared me well for some of my legislative colleagues. And when they throw their temper tantrums, I want to put them in timeout. So I just mentally put them in timeout, and we try not to react. But I think women and my colleagues have learned to balance multiple things. So we can balance, we're able to build constituency. One thing that I think is hard for women is not to disclose everything, and I think this is something that men do much better. I'm so open, I'll just tell you whatever, you know. It's hard for me to be secretive about a bill, you know, or to be a strategy I'm working on, so I'm really poor at that. I've just decided to be who I am, and if I blow it, I blow it. But those are a couple differences that I've noticed.
Great, thank you. You know, I think dovetailing into that is also appreciating the political nuances and understanding that, you know, sometimes I'll say something and afterwards I'll think, oh my gosh, that was really dumb. I should have really thought that strategically about how I should have explained that or who I said it to, because you do. You want to be transparent. You want to bring everybody together. You want to hear what their perspective is. But you don't think about how that could be utilized in the future, either on another bill or what you're working on. So kind of rethinking ahead and what those political nuances and the strategic alliances that can develop in the legislature sometimes takes some rethinking ahead on my part, because I just want to kind of lay it all out like Rhonda said. The other thing, too, and again, I don't want to overgeneralize, but I just have seen it happen so much, is the extent to which I see women legislators work their bills and how, I mean, I think it's our ability to multitask, the fact that we with our professional and personal lives are navigating 15 million different things. My women colleagues are just amazingly hard workers. They're the ones that are staying late. They're the ones that are trying to come up with other solutions to things that they find in conflict. And you know, they're the ones that come at the beginning of the meeting, ready, prepared, with all of their information. They stay all the way to the end. They ask the questions. So again, I hate to overgeneralize, but I do see it a lot that my women colleagues just are amazingly hard workers in the way they work their bills and their policy development.
Great, thank you. Deidre.
Well, I have to say that, you know, I know this is nonpartisan, but the Democrats in our state and probably throughout the nation do a much, much better job with women than as far as having women in office and feeling like they can be there than people on my side of the aisle, and that's something that I would like to see change. So we have, I think in the House and the Senate, the majority of you are women, right, mm-hmm. in both caucuses? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So
out of the five, yeah.
Out of the five, we have three women. But in the Republican side, so there's 24 Republican senators, two of us are women. And so it's a very different dynamic. And one thing that I've noticed, and I really love my colleagues on both sides of that. I think I just have the highest regard for everybody there. I think that we have a very good working relationship, and we have a great legislature. Not perfect by any stretch of the imagination, but women do bring a different perspective to things. I'm a Republican. I am very conservative, along with my colleagues, but there was this one issue that that my colleagues wanted to push last year that gave me great anxiety, and that was bringing tax back, food tax back. Okay, I did not want to see that happen. And I remember one time we were sitting having a discussion, and this came up, and everybody was like, "Yeah, yeah, we got it. It's better for government." And I had just gone through freshman orientation where they said, "Don't talk. You know, don't talk too much. That's the biggest mistake freshmen make. Just don't talk too much." So I felt like I couldn't say anything. And finally, I couldn't take it any longer. And I said, "You know, I have to say something. I don't know how many of you in this room have had to go grocery shopping with a calculator, tallying every little item that you put in your basket, but I have. And more tax on the food means I get to put less things in my basket, fewer things in my basket to feed my family." I said, "This is a terrible idea, right? Yeah, especially at this time of the economy, and you know, Republicans just got bashed for, you know, being anti-women, and this is a horrible idea. This is a terrible thing. I'm totally against this." And you know, and I thought that I would just get, okay, whatever. But I started getting texts from people around the room, my colleagues, saying, "Hey, thanks for saying that. Thanks for doing that." And then later, you know, I asked the senator who was running the bill. I said, "Is this coming up?" Because I finally saw it on my agenda toward the end of the legislative session, and I was chairman of Revenue and Taxation, and that's where the bill was going to come through. And I said, "Do you want me to put this on the agenda?" And he said, "No, I'm not going to run it." And I said, "Why?" And he said, "Because, Deidre, I just kept thinking about, you know, about your words. I hate this bill. I just those words just kept going through my head, and I kept picturing all these women at the grocery store cursing me." So I think our perspective, even if we're on the same side of the aisle, you know, we can help shape some of these policies and think of things that maybe men haven't thought about because we have a different life experience. One isn't better than the other, but they're different and they're complementary, and we need both of those views.
Great. I mean, it's hard to follow those stories, but you know, obviously there's experiences. So I mean, that's critical, and gender is very important. Reproductive health issues. you know, you have a committee with 10 out of 11 people making decisions on women's reproductive health, and you start wondering how much experience they personally have, which is probably going to be none. So you know, you realize the need for that voice. At the same time, I think there are some double standards on how they treat women when it comes to, you know, being in politics, everything from your dress code. I mean, so there's a dress code specifically, and it only mentions male clothing items. I find that unique. But maybe I get away with not having to put a coat, right? So you realize that because of the history, we have not even been at the point where we're now addressing dress code even for women and legislators, especially in the Senate, where we tend to have a little bit more decorum and gets more interesting. And also just the conversations, right? From everything from the constituency. So it's all of us how we also treat, you know, women as candidates and women as elected officials. There is a tendency to saying, well, you know, if it's a man that is a strong man, if he has, you know, if he voiced, you know, vocally an issue, he's a strong man. With a woman, she's called something else. And I won't say the word. And then if the guy cries, he's sensitive. I mean, good for him, and you know, that's the good side of him. Woman cries, she's weak. So we tend to use these stereotypes that are really just demeaning the capacity of any of these wonderful women sitting here, and of course my colleagues, of making real decisions that will have a real impact and that are efficient, effective, and good public policy. So I think we all have to change that. You know, we see it amongst ourselves and within our colleagues, But you also see it in the public, general public, and that takes time because it's going to take experience of seeing more women making good decisions and running the Department of Transportation or running a veterans bill or running, you know, legislation on transportation or things that are not necessarily within, you know, within those boxes where we tend to see women. So that's the exciting part, that you can break that mold, but we need, you know, women to get involved at that level as well.
Great, thank you. I'm going to ask one more question and then open it up for your questions. And I'll start with Rebecca. What one piece of advice would you give to women who want to run for public office, especially young women? Mm-hmm. What would you say to them?
Well, number one, believe in yourself and believe in the strengths that you have already existing. Yes, you'll learn, and yes, you can learn from others. Find a good mentor. You need either somebody that's in office or a great campaign manager or whoever, somebody that you trust that not only mentors you in giving you confidence and saying, go girl, but also saying, hey, you might want to rethink something. Somebody that's very candid with you. I think sometimes, especially when you get into this world of political office, people want to please you as well as you trying to please them. And they won't be as candid with you because they're afraid, well, I don't want to offend her. Make sure you have somebody that is a very trusted mentor that can give you both the pros and cons of where you're going and give you good counsel and good advice. You know, like I mentioned, believe in yourself. Always be open to learning. Always be open to gathering from other people's experiences to strengthen the direction that you go. And surround yourself with, as has been mentioned, a good partner, or you know, make sure that your family understands and appreciates the sacrifices that are going to need to be made on their part. I often have seen families, to be quite honest with you, that struggle with that piece of it. The families don't understand, the spouse doesn't understand what this is going to be like, and so having those conversations early on is very important in having that support network around you and making sure your family knows and appreciates what you're going to get yourself into and that they need to be there for you.
You know, don't think that you have to be perfect to run for political office, or that that you have to be the smartest person, or that you have to be the most talented or the most liked person. You know, I think those kind of self-doubts, and we've talked a bit about self-doubt, and Rebecca mentioned more about that, but just don't let those doubts crowd you in. You know, I'm not a perfect person. For a while when I was first running for office, I thought, what if everything from my past is exposed? You know, all of those stupid things I did as a teenager or as a young adult or going to college or, you know, and I think those are the kinds of doubts that keep a lot of people running from office, thinking that people will judge them. And my best advice is just embrace who you are as an imperfect person and know that the bulk of the people out there are imperfect too. And they're going to love you more because you're imperfect. And when you're out campaigning, campaigning is, I have to tell you, I love door-to-door. I know that sounds sick, but no, I love door-to-door. I love parking lot. You know, it takes a lot to get me out the door to go do it. Mm-hmm. But once I'm out there, I'm connecting with real people. And those real people have needs. And so my best advice is just to be a real person with all your faults and weaknesses, because that's who you're going to represent. If you were a perfect person, you're out campaigning, the voters will look at you and they'll not be able to relate to you. My constituents are fine that I'm not perfect, that there are things I do that are not, you know, not perfect. They like that because they think that I'm human. I'm not judgmental of them. They're not judgmental of me. So I think this idea that you have to have had this perfect education, perfect preparation, done all of these things to get ready to run for political office, it's not the case. You're going to bring to political office who you are and what you are. So just do it. Don't let all those doubts get you.
I think one of the things I'll say is just be honest with yourself and with others. It's what we've lost in American politics is honesty, I think, is the idea of being real. So it's okay to be who you are. It's okay to have the experiences, and all of those experiences bring different perspectives to the conversation, and I think that's what we need, embracing all the differences and being honest, keeping yourself real to just what life is about, right? So yeah, you have to enjoy your family, the people you love, because your neighbor next door that's going to vote for you or not vote for you has the same problems that you have. I mean, at the end of the day, we're, like Representative was saying, trying to manage, you know, oh, I'm not the perfect mom because I, you know, I'm dropping her 15 minutes late to gymnastics. The reality is probably my neighbor is also dropping her kid 15 minutes, you know, because it's just life. You got caught in traffic, you're late from work. And that makes you that connection real. Mm-hmm. And I think what we lack in politics is connecting with real people about real issues. And that has to do a lot with just how, you know, how nasty it gets sometimes that we try to portray people that are not real. So it, for women, especially young women, if they're interested in running, just be yourself, be honest. You don't have to be rich to run for office. I know it's hard because it's very expensive, but it's doable. You get a good team with yourself. Rebecca mentioned this, Representative Chavez mentioned, just get someone that knows what they're doing. I'm not an expert in campaigning. I've done a couple, especially my campaigns, but I get a good team. I mean, I have them here with me today. I mean, just hire a good group of people, a good company that knows what they're doing. They've done this a million times, so it's like any other profession. You don't have to be the expert on campaigning. Now, if you have a minor from the University of Utah, which I endorse, they're awesome. As a political science myself, graduate from the U, great. But not everyone has a minor in political science or, I mean, on campaigning management. So get a good team. We have great experts that are doing it. So I think that's what you need. And then surround yourself by people that really care about you, not the candidate or not the senator, not just you as an individual.
Thank you. There's a saying that goes, opportunity is often overlooked because it's dressed in overalls and looks like hard work. And if I have a piece of advice to give you on how to do this or how to prepare, it would be, don't be afraid of hard work. You may need to roll your sleeves up and do some volunteer work. I started out working on a congressional campaign. I worked an entire year, about 12 to 14 hour days for free. Because I wasn't qualified, I didn't have a minor in political campaigning, I didn't know what I was doing, I wasn't qualified to get a paying job, so I was a volunteer, and I learned a lot, and I became qualified, but it took a lot of hard work, and if I had known at the beginning what I was about to do and get myself involved in, I wouldn't have done it, but I'm so glad I did. Because I learned a lot doing that hard work. It really prepared me for the opportunities that came my way later. And you, as you go throughout life, you need to look at these chances that you have to do some hard work and to do things that'll make a difference and help prepare you that maybe aren't very exciting, but those opportunities prepare you for bigger things down the road. And if you don't do them, if you don't dig in and roll up your sleeves and do some of this hard work, you won't be prepared to run for office if the opportunity presents itself down the road. You've got to prepare yourself. And you can do that in any number of ways, but don't be afraid to roll up your sleeves.
Thank you very much. What topics haven't we covered that you really want to hear about from the panelists today?
Yes.
My name is Vivian Nguyen, and you guys talked about this a little bit, but about the idea of a glass ceiling in politics. Has there been a time where you've faced discrimination with your own peers?
Oh, dear.
I have a story.
Okay, you great. Go ahead. God,
you have the buzz.
Well, I have to start with a disclaimer. I love my colleagues. They're wonderful. But nobody's perfect, right? Right after I was elected, the Senate Republicans had a big fundraiser, and it was in January, right before the legislative session started, at the Grand America Hotel, and there were probably about 500 donors there, and their guests, and so every senator, every Republican senator, was assigned to sit at a table with donors. And the four newly elected members of our Senate leadership, our Senate president, our majority leader, our majority whip, and our assistant whip were all up on stage on stools, and they were answering questions from the audience, written on little cards and passed forward. And I was, as a lowly freshman, seated at a table in the very back of this big ballroom. And one of the questions was asked, and Senate President was reading them, and he's like, you know what, I'm going to have Senator Henderson come up and answer this next question. And I thought, wow.
It must be a taxation question.
He wants me to come and answer a policy question. That's, as a freshman, I just was really honored. So I pick my way through the tables and go all the way up to the front of the room, and I get up on stage, and I get handed a microphone, and the question was, if this were the dating game, which of these senators would you pick? And I said, why are you asking me this? And then I said, you're all winners. And I handed the microphone back, and I went and sat down. By the time I got back to the table, I just thought, did that really happen to me?
2013.
And the men, thankfully, the men at my table, they were all men there, you know, were outraged, and they were very nice to me. But and later, I did get a public apology, and, you know, it's all water in the bridge, and it was dumb, just not thinking. I've never felt that from them before, but there are instances where those types of things happen, and I have to give my advice here. In these types of situations, you got to have a sense of humor.
Absolutely.
You got to not take things personally. You know, there are times when it's going to be a learning experience for some people, and maybe a little bit painful. Probably a lot more painful for him than it was for me. And that's unfortunate, because he's a very good man, and he's not like that at all. But those things happen, and you have to deal with it. But you do need to deal with it with grace, and maybe sometimes a sense of humor.
Let's take another question.
Can I just add really quickly?
Yes,
I think
please. Part
of having more women in office will start to alleviate
yes,
that too.
Yes, it will.
And I think it also alleviates the problem that I run into oftentimes, which is when I'm at an event with my husband and people don't know who we are, they assume that he's the legislator and I'm
right. Not.
And I think, again, it's because they assume the men are the legislators, the women are not. So the more that we have women in office, the more that those incidences, I think, will be more few
Absolutely.
And far between.
Great. Yes.
My name is Tyler Glauser. And so my question is, as women, do you all have children? You all had children, so you obviously have seen in the growth of your children how important a parent can be. And so my question is, as evidence has kind of gone up supporting traditional families with a husband and a wife who are married and committed to their family has kind of increased, traditional families, the percentage of traditional families has actually decreased. So my question is, as women in the legislature, I think that's a great opportunity, because it seems like women usually understand better than men how to raise children, to promote that. Is there anything being done promoting just traditional families with a husband and a wife who are married in our society, who are committed to their relationship?
Thank you. Anyone want to speak to that?
Do you want me to take it? I'd be happy to. We have a constitutional amendment defining marriage as marriage between a man and a woman. You know that this is fairly controversial right now based upon the Supreme Court decision and in legislation in other states. I will tell you, Utah has a very conservative legislature. We make a lot of decisions based upon those conservative values. And fortunately, it goes across the board. And if you look at our Democratic colleagues and our Republican colleagues, and you look at conservative decisions that we make, where we protect families, you would see that we are very consistently voting together. So that's one thing we're doing in Utah. The other thing we do in Utah is we work a lot with social service programs. All of us are seated here. We look at social services programs through the window of trying to preserve the relationship between parents and a child. And we make child welfare decisions based on that. We make funding decisions based on that. We're talking right now about some new Medicaid decisions that would honor those relationships between parents and children. I think if you're going to be in a state in the nation that values a family, now how that family gets defined in the future, we probably could have a great debate, and I'm not going to go there.
And I realize now that I probably didn't phrase my question the way that I wanted to. As soon as I said that, I kind of realized that. But thank you for that.
But I think... You know, I think we're concerned about family values.
And there's many definitions to family, and I, you know, and we have the same, if any, varies, maybe lower, slightly lower rate of divorce in Utah than any other state. So, I mean, I think overall we rank with many other states in the nation, but our priorities, you know, is child welfare is critical. But we have grandparents that are taking roles of raising children, you know, single parents that are raising children, very, very engaged fathers that may have gone through a divorce. And we see that in all the policy decision-making process. And I run legislation to make sure, you know, adoptive parents have certain rights, biological parents as well. When you're in policy-making decision position, your values are critical in your thinking, but you have to think about your constituents. And there, this is public policy, and many of you are part, if you're in the Hinckley Institute, and like I said, I love this the programs at the U, you learn that public policy is broader than just your perspective. It's about every single constituent. It's about low-income families. It's about maybe, you know, highly educated communities versus individuals that may not have just a high school graduation rates. So there's a broader perspective, but I think overall, as a legislator, you're making decisions on all of them. But you can't just bring, you know, a very, you know, single focus perspective or your experience if you are fortunate enough to come from, you know, whatever that picture perfect traditional family looks like. You know, that may not be the situation of other families, and you also are legislating and being a representative of everybody else in that constituency.
Great. Yes, one more question. Oh, is there someone who already has the microphone? Please, go ahead.
My name is Christy, and I've actually been aspiring and interested into the Utah legislature for about 4 years now. I know I'm a little one, but that's okay. But my question is, with the Real Women campaign, and as a lot of you have said that you weren't really thinking about politics before you got into it, what are your educational backgrounds? What are your very, because you both, all of you sound very different with your educational backgrounds, so what are they?
Well, I have yet to check college graduate off my bucket list, and hopefully now I've got two college students, and hopefully I can finish my degree at some point, but I don't have a degree yet. I dropped out of college after I got married. I had to work two jobs to help get my husband through school, and then I had five babies in 8 years. So my time has not come, and I'm doing things a little bit backwards in my life. But I have taken continuing education courses throughout the years as I can, and while I may lack letters behind my name, I feel like I've had a very good education, and I feel like I'm very well educated. I still have that goal, and hopefully someday I will achieve it. But you know, when I was in college at Brigham Young University, but now my daughter's an Aggie, so I'm an Aggies fan. I was going to be a choir teacher. I mean, politics was like not even on my radar. I'm such a different person, I guess, intellectually now than I was back then, that you know, I would do things very differently. I will do things very differently now. I don't know how you go back to college when you're in the legislature, but you know, we'll figure it out.
I can help you
with
that.
We'll figure it out.
The right Aggies can help you.
So I'm one of those real women. Who, you know, because of economic necessity, I simply hadn't been able to finish that. And that's one of the things, I have four daughters and one son, and one of the things that I pounding into my daughters is, you've got to finish your education. You can't take a back seat to, if you get married, you can't take a back seat to your husband. You never know what's going to happen. It's just as important for women to finish their education as it is for men. And that's one of my, I don't regret what I did, because I feel like I did what I had to do, and I don't regret my children or my husband or any of that. But I do wish I would have been able to stick that out at the beginning of my life, rather than whenever it is I'm going to be able to finish that. So,
You know, I think that what we find in public policy development in any representative portion of our government is that you have people that come to that table with different life experiences. And there is just as much richness from somebody that may not have completed
a degree in a certain field as someone who has. And I think that that's what helps us come up with good solutions as we bring all of these perspectives and experiences in education to the table to come up with solutions. You know, yes, I've got an MPA and I've got my bachelor's degree in journalism, but it took me a while to get that MPA. I didn't get my MPA until I was in my mid-40s. So, yes, I have that education, but I also relish the experiences that my colleagues bring that may not have completed their post-secondary degrees, and just the life experiences also color the way that we make our decisions and are very important. As Senator Robles said, just like with life experiences, guiding public policy, depending on a family constellation and how it's made, and those experiences of a single mom or a grandmother that's raising a child, or a woman who may have been widowed at a young age and may not have had a choice about whether or not her husband is with her or not to raise her children. Those are the experiences that we have to listen to and understand how the policy affects those lives, and the policy perspectives or the life experiences and the life perspectives also of our colleagues color that. So it's more about experiences, and it's more about being humble. I mean, I think we all have to approach that in some way.
Good points. I'm lucky to have, I'm addicted to education, you have to know. Every fall, I feel like I have to be in school. I did take 10 years off to have 5 kids in 6 years. I had a set of twins. So anyway, I grew up a first generation kid on a farm. Education was not optional to me. My parents drilled that into me, and I had strong passion for that. So I did undergrad, master's degree right away. Entered my career field teaching, and then took a break. My husband and I at a point in our lives decided he needed a PhD, so I took a full-time job. We moved our kids to student housing, 5 kids in a single wide trailer, and said we're going to get, he said he was going to get his PhD. And after he went for a year, I looked at what he was doing and I said, we're here, there's money for me to go to school, people will pay for me to get my PhD, I'm going to do it too. So we had a great conversation as a family. How are we going to do this? I have to tell you, my kids helped with my dissertation. They can tell you about many nights they slept on the floor in my office helping me with my dissertation and helping me get ready for class, preparing PowerPoints. I remember my son doing my first PowerPoint for a class presentation. And so I think it's just whatever happens in your life and what educational opportunities come to you, they're going to be different. And not there's no single pathway in, to education. But the thing I like about what we've done with higher ed, we've made it much more accessible for women. And you don't have to be choosing one or the other anymore. You can choose, and someone said to me in a very critical way, which I could have taken to be very offensive, said, oh, you just want it all. And you know, at the moment I bristled and I thought, that's really mean. And then I smiled and said, yeah, you're right. I do want it all. And there's no reason I can't have it all, is there? And you know, the person couldn't respond to that, right? They couldn't say, no, you can't have it all. So I think what we've done in this modern world is we've opened the door for men and women. And I'll tell you, my husband couldn't do what he does, and we tag team. He has an important position right now. I had to step out of a leadership position to allow, you know, for him, because there were too many conflicts. And so we've done this tag team relationship. My kids are great. There are times that I stop doing what I'm doing so I can be with them and help them. So I don't think there's one way to do it.
So I'm a graduate from the University of Utah. I have a bachelor's in science and business marketing, and then my master's in public administration, like Representative Chavez, and love the U. Was very pregnant with one of our professors here when I did my MPA. I finished, had my oral exam 2 days before giving birth to my baby. So, that was 9 years ago. So, you know, and I just being blessed to that, have parents with PhDs and professors at university, so the education was not, you know, it was just what we were going to get to college. And proud to say that my brother graduated from Stanford with a PhD in chemical engineering. He got the brains, I got the looks, so we're okay. That's how we split this whole thing. But you know, it's again a family endeavor. I mean, I believe their choices, but you're right. That on life experience is what really makes those gives you those opportunities to make real good choices. Education, it helps. I mean, absolutely. I think the master's program, I mean, our graduate program here at the U, again, I serve on the College of Social Behavioral Science, so we love if you guys stay. And those programs are very unique because they're executive programs where you put your life experience, your professional experience, to work on an MPA or a master's program. And I just value education. I'm like, I miss not being at school. I've been thinking, you know, taking some classes for a PhD program
come
in
teach.
Desperation, yeah.
Teach
Don't teach with, you know, but I, you know, great experience. And like I said, I mean, I think we are at a point where it's okay to see a very, very pregnant woman. I didn't realize how big I was, but I'm sure I'm sorry for my friends that were there and our professors that were like, are you okay? I'm like, yes, I'm fine. But we, you know, it's unique. I mean, they open the opportunities and you go and do it, and it was a great experience. Full-time job and pregnant and going to school. But.
Thank you so much. We've come to the end of our time for today, and I want to thank the Hinckley Institute and the Benyon Center for co-sponsoring the forum today, and especially thank all four panelists for your thoughtful and insightful remarks about women in Utah politics.
Mm-hmm.
Will you join
awesome.
Me in
thanking
you?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, I love it. That's a tour.